हेलो एवरीवन, सो दिस इज फर्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ साइंस क्लास 10th, केमिकल रिएक्शंस एंड इक्वेशंस. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू ऐड वन थिंग दैट इन आवर नेचर और इन आवर सराउंडिंग नथिंग इज परमानेंट. देयर कम्स सम डिफरेंसेस एवरी टाइम. सो ऑल दीज डिफरेंसेस विच एनकाउंटर बाय अस आर कॉल्ड चेंजेस. ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ साइंस चेंजेस कैन बी ऑफ टू टाइप्स, physical changes and chemical changes. And about these changes, you people have learned in your previous classes. So I'm just brushing up the things quickly. In physical changes, as we know that the most important thing is that no new substance is formed. They are generally, they can be like a change in a state, maybe there, or their color can change or temperature can change. So no new substance is formed over there. So only physical properties are changed. This is called physical change, like cutting of paper, tearing of cloth, or melting of ice. These are the physical changes. In these cases, nothing new is formed. While the chemical changes are certain changes in which always a new substance is formed. This is the characteristic of chemical change. We can identify easily. If something new is formed with totally different properties, those properties may be of physical or as well as chemical properties may be there, like burning of paper, burning of wood, burning of candle, they all are chemical changes, or cooking of food. So these are the examples of chemical changes. So let us see now what are chemical reactions. During a chemical change, one or more substances are changed into new substances having totally different properties, and these properties can be physical as well as chemical. Such are called chemical reactions. Or we can say that every chemical change is associated by a chemical reaction, because in chemical change we have seen that something new is forming, and that new is formed by changing. And those changes comes in their physical or chemical properties. Now, what is reaction? It is a term used for depicting a change in which a substance can decompose or combines with other substance or interchanges constituents with other substances. To show all these things, we used a reaction. So, how can you say that a chemical change has taken place? So we can say a few things, one or more thing if it is there. So we can say that a chemical change has taken place. Like, there may be a change in state of matter. See here, I have given one example. Here hydrogen gas and oxygen gas are reacting together and water is formed. These two were in gaseous form, while the water which is forming here is in liquid state. So this shows that a chemical change has taken place, because these two were gases and the product is a liquid. There may be a change in color. Like I have given here one example, potassium permanganate, which is pink in color. But when we add lemon juice to it, this pink color disappears. So change in color also shows sometimes that the chemical change has taken place. There may be change in temperature, like calcium oxide, which is also known as quicklime. When water is added to it, we see that calcium hydroxide is formed, which is called slaked lime, and the entire content becomes hot. Means heat is liberated. We are not providing it heat and there is no heat in our surrounding. Still, when we add these two things, it instantaneously gets heated up. So heat is liberated here. So change in temperature also shows the presence of chemical change. There may be evolution of gas. For an example, if zinc granules are kept in or added up with hydrochloric acid, we see that zinc chloride is formed, and in the liquid hydrogen gas is evolved in form of bubbles. So formation of gas also shows that something new has formed, because see, there is no gaseous content, but here the gas is evolving, and this shows that some chemical change has taken place. One thing also can be seen here during a chemical change, that is formation of precipitate. What are precipitate? We will see a later on. So here in the example, I have taken lead nitrate, which is a transparent solution, or we can say colorless solution. It is added up with potassium iodide, which is also a transparent colorless solution. But when these two things are added up, we see that potassium nitrate is formed, which is also a colorless solution, but along with that, a yellow color substance, which is lead iodide, is formed, which is solid in its state. So this solid state is forming, which is insoluble, and it settles down at the bottom of the container in which this reaction is taking place. So this is called precipitate. So formation of precipitate also shows that certain chemical change has taken place, because previously no colored substance was there, but suddenly a colored precipitate, a solid insoluble substance, is forming from clear solutions. Now the next thing, what is a chemical equation? Right now though we have seen that a chemical change can be associated by a chemical reaction. Now what is chemical equation? A chemical reaction is written in form of symbols or formula of the chemical compound or elements involved in the reaction. So it is basically a pattern to write a chemical reaction in a shorter form or a symbolic form, so that it becomes easier for us to understand it. It also indicates the types and number of atoms of each element involved. Chemical equations are very useful to us. They are very informative, as we can get to know what type of elements are involved in it and what is the number of atoms that are participating in a chemical reaction. For example, this is a word equation. When magnesium ribbon is burnt in presence of oxygen gas, magnesium oxide is produced. So this is a chemical reaction. So we want to write in a precise form. So what we can do, either we can go for writing the names like this, that magnesium, it is adding up with oxygen gas, or we can say that it is reacting with oxygen gas and magnesium oxide is formed. Or we can write it in symbolic form, as we know that the symbol of magnesium is Mg and the symbol of oxygen gas is O2. So we have written Mg plus O2 gives MgO, which is magnesium oxide. Now, by seeing the chemical equation, what information we are getting? Let us see and how to write a chemical equation. First of all, reactants. The chemical substances that takes part in a chemical reaction are called reactant, and they are written on the left side. This is the left side, and these chemicals are participating in the reaction, so they are written as reactant. While the chemical substances that are formed after the reaction are called product, and they are written on the right side. This is the right side, and this is the substance which is produced after the reaction, so it is called a product. So reactants are written on the left side and products are written on the right side. If more than two reactants or products are joined, so they are joined with a plus sign. If two or more reactants or products are there, so they will be shown by a plus sign. See here, there are more than two reactants, so I have put a plus sign. If the products were more than one, so that time also I have joined them with a plus sign. The direction of arrow between the reactant and product shows the direction of reaction. See here, between reactant and product I have marked an arrow, and this direction of arrow shows the direction of reaction. Means these two things are reacting together and this substance is forming during the reaction. So this way the arrow shows the direction of reaction. Now what is a skeletal reaction equation? Chemical equation in which number of atoms of any particular element are not equal in both the sides, such an equation is called skeletal equation. What does that mean? Let us see with the help of a equation. Here I have taken the same reaction, that magnesium is burning in presence of oxygen and magnesium oxide is forming here. Let us check the number of atoms of each element on both the sides. See here, in the reactant, the number of magnesium atom is 1. And in the product, the number of magnesium atom is also 1. While if we check the reactant, that oxygen is having 2 atoms. While in products, the number of oxygen is 1. So there is a difference between the number of atoms of oxygen. Such a equation is called skeletal equation, in which the number of atoms of any particular element is not equal on both sides. So this is a kind of skeletal equation. Now next thing, balanced equation. What is a balanced equation and why do we need to balance an equation? So first we are going to see that thing, why there is necessity of balancing the equation. In class 9, you have seen the law of conservation of mass. So according to law of conservation of mass, mass or atoms can neither be created nor be destroyed during a chemical reaction. It means that the total number of atoms of each type of element should be equal on both sides of the equation, and such an equation is called balanced equation. It means whatever the elements are there, their number of atoms should be equal on both of the sides. Let us understand it by taking an example. We are going to balance the equation. Again, I have taken the same example, that is of magnesium burning in presence of oxygen to form magnesium oxide. The first step is count the number of atoms of various elements on both sides. We are going to count the number of atoms, which we have done in the previous step also. See here, magnesium, its number is 1 in reactant and its number is also 1 in the products. While the number of oxygen atom is 2 in reactant and it is 1 in products. Now step 2, to balance the other element having uneven number of atoms, multiply the whole molecule with a small whole number. We have to see which element we have to balance, and to balance it we have to multiply the entire molecule with a small whole number. In the following example, at product side, oxygen atom is 1, while at reactant it is 2. We see here that the number of magnesium is same, but the number of oxygen is different. So we have to balance it. If it is 2 here, we have to make it 2 also. So what do we multiply with 1 to get 2? Yes, it is 2. We have to multiply the entire molecule with 2. So I have written at this thing, to balance oxygen we have to multiply magnesium oxide with 2. We have to multiply the entire molecule. So what will happen if we multiply 2 with MgO? So this 2 is going to be multiplied with the number of magnesium also. So 2 into 1, that is 2. Now 2 into 1 of oxygen, that is 2. Now this time the number of atoms of magnesium also becomes 2, and the number of oxygen atom will also become 2. Now let us see what change occurs here. The oxygen is balanced. 2 atoms here and 2 atoms here also. But what about magnesium? If we have multiplied the entire molecule with 2, the magnesium converts into 2. While in reactant, the number of magnesium is now 1. So we have to change this one also so that it converts into 2. Now this time, what we will multiply 1 with? Okay, again with 2. So see here, number of oxygen atom is balanced. Okay, but number of magnesium has changed. Now to balance it, multiply magnesium, which is at reactant part, by 2. So we are going to multiply it by 2. We are multiplying the magnesium with 2, so it becomes 2. and here it is 2 and here also it is 2 and oxygen is also 2 and 2 here also. So in both the cases we have got the same number. Oxygen is 2 and 2 here, or and the magnesium is also similar, that is 2 and 2. Now the equation is balanced at the number of magnesium and oxygen atoms are equal at both sides. We have to check individual element whether they are having the same number of atoms or not. It does not mean that the entire reaction will be having this same number or only one number of atoms. So I have taken one more example to explain this thing. In this case, this is iron reacting with water to form iron oxide and hydrogen. So what we are going to do, we will balance, we will write the number of atoms of all the elements. Here iron having one atom, in water the number of atom of hydrogen is 2 and the number of oxygen is 1. This number shows the number of atoms, and where there is nothing written it is considered to be as 1. That is why iron is also considered as 1 and here oxygen is also considered as 1. Here we see that iron is having the number of atoms 3, oxygen atoms are 4 and hydrogen atoms are 2. So now we will start with balancing the element which is having the highest number of atoms. So let us check. 4 means oxygen is the element which is having the highest number of atoms. So we are going to start by balancing oxygen. If we see in product, the number of oxygen atom is 4, while in that reactant it is only 1. So first of all, what we have to do, we have to convert this 1, we have to multiply this with a number by which we can convert 1 into 4. So for that we have to multiply the entire molecule with 4. So see here what I have done. Iron is as it is written, and water molecule I am multiplying the entire molecule by 4, and the products are written as same. If I multiply this water molecule with 4, what changes will be there? As I have told you earlier that the written number is multiplied by all the atoms which are present in the molecule. So when 4 will be multiplied by 2, that is the number of atom of hydrogen. So 4 2s are 8. Now hydrogen atoms will be 8 and oxygen will be 4 into 1, that is 4. So what we have thought for, that the oxygen number will be balanced. So it is the same here. In reactant and product, in both the sides the number of oxygen becomes similar, that is 4. Now see the next element having the highest number of atoms. Now if we see the number of atoms, we will find that hydrogen is having the highest number of atoms, that is 8. While in the product side, the hydrogen is only 2. So what we have to do so that 2 converts into 8? Yes, of course, we will multiply this hydrogen by 4. So see the next step what I have done. Iron as it is, 4H2O, which we have changed, iron oxide as it is, and hydrogen I am multiplying by 4. If I multiply the hydrogen by 4, what it will convert into? 4 2s are 8. So now let us check once again. Oxygen was already balanced, 4 and 4. Now we have also balanced hydrogen, 8 atoms here as well as 8 atoms in product also. Now see the leftover element, which is iron. If we see in reactant, the number of atom of iron is 1 only, while in product number of iron atoms are 3. So now what we have to do, we have to convert this 1 into 3. So we have to multiply it by exactly 3. So this thing I have written here, I have multiplied iron by 3. So what will happen, 3 into 1, 3, and this the entire part is already done here. So let us check whether the number of all the elements are equal to each other or not. So iron is 3 in reactant side, and in product it is also 3. Hydrogen is 8 in reactants and also 8 at products, and oxygen is 4 in both the sides. In this way, the number of particular element becomes balanced, and this type of chemical equation is called balanced equation, as number of particular atom of an element is equal on both the sides. Apart from this, we can make the chemical equation more informative. What else we can add into it? Like, we can write the state of matter. If the substance is in solid form, we write S. If it is in liquid form, we write small l. If it is gaseous form, G is written. And if it is an aqueous solution, then AQ is written. If we have to provide certain conditions for the reaction to take place, we will mention those conditions above the arrow, which we put in between. On this arrow, we will write the conditions. It can be temperature, pressure, or any catalyst if it is used. Now, a gaseous product is indicated by an arrow pointing upward. If any product is formed which is in gaseous form, then an upward arrow is shown along with it. If some precipitate is formed, then it is shown by down facing arrow. Precipitate are basically solid, insoluble substances which settle down at the bottom. So as they are going to be settled down at the bottom, so they are shown by a down facing arrow, or we can show it like this. To show the concentration, we are not going to mention the value as it is. Instead of that, diluted term is written as DIL and concentrated solution is written as CONC. These concentrations are shown for acids and bases. Now, if there is certain energy changes there, it is shown as. If heat is released, means it is produced or evolved, then plus heat is written at product side. Means heat is returned along the products. And if heat is absorbed, then heat is returned with reactant, or minus heat is written at product side. So all these things will be clear to you when I will give you later examples. Now, what are the different types of chemical reactions? So first type of chemical reaction is called combination reaction. Combination word arises from the word combine, which means to join. Here, in such type of reactions, two or more reactants join together to form a single product. So it is in symbolic form, like two substances are there and they are joining together and they are forming a totally new product, which is one in number only. Okay, so two reactants are joining together to form one product. So I have given you a few examples showing this thing, like magnesium is reacting with oxygen, or we can say that magnesium is burning in presence of oxygen and magnesium oxide is formed. Here, hydrogen gas is reacting with oxygen gas to form water. Here, hydrogen gas is reacting with chlorine gas to form hydrochloric acid gas. Here, carbon is burnt in presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide gas. In all these cases, we can see that two reactants are combining together to form a single product. Now, second type of reaction is called decomposition reaction. The word decomposition arises from decompose, which means to break down. In these reactions, one reactant is going to break down into two or more products. So, to break down the reactant, we have to supply energy in form of heat, light, or electricity. Means in these reactions, energy is going to be absorbed. On the basis of type of energy provided to them, decomposition reactions can be of three types. The first type of decomposition reaction is called thermal decomposition. The thermal word means temperature or heat. So these are the decomposition reactions which occur by heating the reactant. Simply we heat the reactant and it decomposes. So I have given here one example. This is lead nitrate. Two molecules of lead nitrate. When we heat this lead nitrate, we see that lead oxide is formed, PbO. It is a solid. Then nitrogen oxide gas is released and oxygen gas is also evolved. When this reaction takes place, if we take this lead nitrate in a test tube and we start heating it on a burner, we will see after a while that a brown color fume arises from there. Brown color fume, already it was not present, but when the reaction takes place, it starts appearing, and that brown color fume is of nitrogen oxide. So we see that the lead nitrate has decomposed into three substances. So one more of a thermal decomposition example I have taken here. This is iron sulfate or ferrous sulfate crystals. So this is a formula of ferrous sulfate crystals, which are green in color. When it is heated, first of all the crystalline water is removed. See here, the water is removed by heating and ferrous sulfate is retained, which is white in color. Earlier its color was green, but as soon as the crystalline water removes from it, it turns into white color. If we keep on heating this ferrous sulfate, what will happen? That it breaks down to form ferric oxide, which is brown in color, sulfur dioxide and sulfur trioxide gases are released, which are having a property, that characteristic sulfur smell. The second type of decomposition reaction are electrolysis. These are decomposition reactions which generally occur by the help of electricity. For this, I have taken the example of electrolysis of water. For this, I have explained, I have drawn a diagram of an activity to explain this thing to you. For this, we have taken a plastic mug or plastic jar. At its bottom, we have made two holes and we have kept two rubber stoppers, and we have fitted two graphite rods in it, which are going to behave like an electrode. Then we have poured some water in it, and we have added some one or two drops of sulfuric acid to make it acidified water. Then we will fill two test tubes with normal water and turn them upside down on the electrodes or the graphite rods. And at the outside, we connect these electrodes with a 6-volt battery. The terminal which is added to the positive terminal will behave as an anode, and the negative terminal will behave as a cathode. And in between, we have kept a switch. We will see that as soon as we switch it on, after some time or after few minutes, we will see that in both the test tubes, some bubbles start appearing. These bubbles are of gases. So what gases are going to be evolved? If we check the reaction, when water, when electricity is passed through water, hydrogen and oxygen gases are formed. We know that hydrogen is always in a positive ion form, while oxygen form a negative ion. And in previous classes also, we have read that opposite ions attract each other. So see, oxygen first, which is negative in charge, it will get attracted towards the anode, because oxygen is negatively charged while anode is positively charged. So what will happen? That oxygen starts collecting in this test tube by displacing water. It starts collecting at the top of the test tube, and the water will evacuate from the bottom. And for hydrogen, hydrogen is positively charged, so it will move towards cathode, which is negatively charged. So in this test tube, we will see bubbles and some gas start collecting here, and this gas is going to be hydrogen. One more thing we will see here, that the volume of hydrogen is double than the volume of oxygen. It is because its molecular formula itself implies this thing. The molecular formula of water is H2O. If we write the number of atoms here, that is 2:1, means in every molecule of water, 2 atoms of hydrogen and 1 atom of oxygen is there. Means the number or the mass of hydrogen, we can't say mass, we will say that the number of hydrogen atom is double here. So the total volume of the hydrogen is also doubled as compared to oxygen. Now, how will we get to know which gases collide at which side? So simple tests are there to identify which gases collected. For that, we have to take a burning matchstick near to the gas-filled, test tubes. When we bring a burning matchstick near to a gas-filled test tube, if that gas burns with a clean blue flame, it means that gas is surely oxygen. And if we bring a burning matchstick to a test tube and that matchstick lit off with a pop sound, it means that gas is hydrogen gas. So these are the sure test of oxygen and hydrogen gases. Now the third type of decomposition reaction is called photolysis. These are the decomposition reactions occurred by light energy, especially the sunlight. For that, these are the examples. This is silver chloride, which is white in color. When it is kept open in sunlight, after some time it will dissociate or decompose into silver and chlorine, and the silver is gray in color. While the silver chloride was white in color, the silver which is released over here turns gray. Same way, this is silver bromide. When it is kept open in sunlight, it dissociates or decomposes into silver and bromine. This reaction of silver bromide is used in black and white photography. Now, here are some other examples of decomposition reactions. Different type of decomposition reactions are taken. This is a potassium chlorate. KClO3 is potassium chlorate. When it is heated, it produces potassium chloride and oxygen gases release. So this is an example of thermal decomposition. Here is an example. When methane is reacted with a catalyst, then carbon and hydrogen gets separated. And one more decomposition reaction example is also here, that is aluminium oxide. When in its molten state, when electricity is passed through it, it dissociates into aluminium and oxygen. So these reactions are used during the extraction of metals from their ores. Now the third type of chemical reaction is called exothermic reaction. In such reactions, heat is given out along with the product. Exo means to release, thermal means heat. Means in these reaction, heat is released or given out along with the product. So we can write it as reactant and the products plus heat. Heat is released along with the product. As the heat is released, the temperature of the system increases. In such reaction, the system temperature will increase. Examples can be all type of combustion reaction. Combustion means burning reaction. Wherever burning takes place, these are also exothermic reaction. So here we have seen, we will see that carbon is combusting or burning in presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide gas, and heat is liberated. Now in the second example of the same, methane gas, which is a fuel, and it is burning in presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide, water vapor, and heat is liberated. So in both the cases, heat is releasing out. So they are the example of exothermic reaction. Now formation of water from hydrogen and oxygen gas is also an exothermic process, because it also liberates heat. The heat is that much that the water which is earlier produced in liquid state, it converts into its vapor form. And surprisingly, the respiration which takes place in our body is also a exothermic process. In respiration, the glucose which we intake in form of food, which reaches in form of glucose in our cell, and the oxygen which we inhale. So glucose gets burnt in presence of oxygen in our cell to produce carbon dioxide, water, and energy is released. And this is the energy which is used by us for doing several life processes. That is why respiration is also considered as an exothermic reaction. Now next are endothermic reaction. Endothermic, endo means inside, taking the heat inside. It means in these reaction heat is going to be absorbed. And for this, to show this thing, we can write the equation in two form. Either the heat is written with reactant, reactant plus heat equals to product, or we can write it in form of reactant equals to product minus heat. Means minus heat, it shows the loss of heat, and if there is loss of heat, the temperature of the system is going to decrease. Now for example we have I have taken here, that is nitrogen is reacting with oxygen and heat is absorbed for this purpose and nitrogen oxide is formed. Apart from this, all the decomposition reactions are a kind of endothermic reaction, because in all of them heat is provided. Thermal decomposition reaction we have seen. So all the thermal decomposition reactions are also endothermic reactions, because for them we are adding up heat to them. That ammonia, it is absorbing heat and dissociating or decomposing into nitrogen and hydrogen. Water is decomposed by absorbing electricity into hydrogen and oxygen, and this is calcium carbonate. When it is heated up, it is decomposed into calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. So in all these reactions, we see that energy is written along with the reactants. This case, reactant plus heat equals to product. Or what we have we can write this heat at the side of product, but that time we have to write it like minus heat. Now the next type of reactions are displacement reactions. In displacement reaction, what happens? That highly reactive element displaces less reactive element from its compound. A highly reactive element is going to displace or remove a less reactive element from its compound. So what are highly reactive element and what are less reactive element? To understand that, we have to see the reactivity series. This is the reactivity series of some elements which we get by performing several chemical reactions and processes, by which we can get to know which elements are highly reacting and which are less reactive. So we have put them in a series on the basis of their decreasing reactivity. So this is like at the top they are the most reactive elements, and as we come down they becomes the least reactive. So potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, lead, hydrogen, copper, mercury, silver and gold. In this series the reactivity decreases. The important thing that what I have told you, that highly reactive element is going to displace the less reactive, means the element which is at above any element can displace all the elements which lies under it. Means potassium can displace all the elements which lies under. As the heat is released, the temperature of the system increases. In such reaction, the system temperature will increase. Examples can be all type of combustion reaction. Combustion means burning reaction. Wherever burning takes place, these are also exothermic reaction. So here we have seen, we will see that carbon is combusting or burning in presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide gas, and heat is liberated. Now, in the second example of the same, methane gas, which is a fuel and it is burning in presence of oxygen to produce carbon dioxide, water vapor and heat is liberated. So, in both the cases, heat is releasing out. So, they are the example of exothermic reaction. Now, formation of water from hydrogen and oxygen gas is also an exothermic process because it also liberates heat. The heat is that much that the water which is earlier produced in liquid state, it converts into its vapor form. And surprisingly, the respiration which takes place in our body is also a exothermic process. In respiration, the glucose which we intake in form of food, which reaches in form of glucose in our cell, and the oxygen which we inhale. So glucose gets burnt in presence of oxygen in our cell to produce carbon dioxide, water, and energy is released. And this is the energy which is used by us for doing several life processes. That is why respiration is also considered as an exothermic reaction. Now, next are endothermic reaction. Endothermic, endo means inside, taking the heat inside. It means in these reaction heat is going to be absorbed. And for this, to show this thing, we can write the equation in two form. Either the heat is written with reactant, reactant plus heat equals to product, or we can write it in form of reactant equals to product minus heat. Means minus heat, it shows the loss of heat, and if there is loss of heat, the temperature of the system is going to decrease. Now, for example, one example we have I have taken here, that is nitrogen is reacting with oxygen and heat is absorbed for this purpose and nitrogen oxide is formed. Apart from this, all the decomposition reactions are a kind of endothermic reaction because in all of them heat is provided. Thermal decomposition reaction we have seen. So all the thermal decomposition reactions are also endothermic reactions, because for them we are adding up heat to them. That ammonia, it is absorbing heat and dissociating or decomposing into nitrogen and hydrogen. Water is decomposed by absorbing electricity into hydrogen and oxygen, and this is calcium carbonate. When it is heated up, it is decomposed into calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. So in all these reactions, we see that energy is written along with the reactants. This case, reactant plus heat equals to product. Or what we have done, what we can do, we can write this heat at the side of product, but that time we have to write it like minus heat. Now, the next type of reactions are displacement reactions. In displacement reaction, what happens? That highly reactive element displaces less reactive element from its compound. A highly reactive element is going to displace or remove a less reactive element from its compound. So what are highly reactive element and what are less reactive element? To understand that, we have to see the reactivity series. This is the reactivity series of some elements which we get by performing several chemical reactions and processes, by which we can get to know ki which elements are highly reacting and which are less reactive. So we have put them in a series on the basis of their decreasing reactivity. So this is like at the top they are the most reactive elements, and as we come down they becomes the least reactive. So potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, lead, hydrogen, copper, mercury, silver and gold. In this series the reactivity decreases. The important thing that what I have told you, that highly reactive element is going to displace the less reactive, means the element which is at above any element can displace all the elements which lies under it. Means potassium can displace all the elements which lies under. What about sodium? It can displace all the elements which lies under it, but it cannot displace potassium. Now what about zinc? If we talk about zinc, it will displace all the elements which underlies it, but it cannot displace the elements which are above it. So by learning this reactivity series, we can get to know whether this reaction is going to occur or not. So here we have taken some examples. This is copper sulfate. The solution of copper sulfate is blue in color. If we keep some iron nail in it, what will be there? First of all, let us check the position of copper and iron. Copper and iron. This is copper, which is in its compound form, and iron, which is in its free form. So iron is highly reactive because it lies over copper. So in this reaction, iron can easily displace the copper, which is less reactive, from its compound. So same thing happened here. Iron has displaced copper and it becomes iron sulfate, and copper is removed. See here, copper is removed. Iron has taken the place of copper. So the solution which was earlier blue, it turns green, and the surface of iron becomes brown. Some more example of the displacement reaction are sulfuric acid plus zinc. We can see here zinc is highly reactive. It can easily displace hydrogen. So in this reaction, zinc is going to displace hydrogen from its compound. So zinc has taken its place and it converts ZnSO4, and hydrogen gas is released. Same way, copper sulfate plus zinc. Again, we can see that zinc lies over the copper, so it can easily displace copper from its compound. So zinc sulfate and copper is formed here. Same way, copper sulfate sulfate plus magnesium. See here, magnesium is also at the top, means it is highly reactive, so it can easily displace copper from its compound, and the new products are magnesium sulfate and copper. One more example is copper chloride plus lead. See here, copper chloride and lead is highly reactive because it is over the copper again. So it will displace copper from its compound, and lead chloride will be formed and copper will be released. Now, last example, right now we have seen that in all the cases, most of the elements were displacing copper. Is there any case where copper can displace? Now, the next type of reactions we are going to study are double displacement reaction. So there are few important things regarding this type of reactions. First of all, these type of reactions takes place between two ionic compounds. Ionic compounds means the compounds which are formed by association of ions, negative and positive ions. So for first of all, these compounds, they break down into their associated ions, and then there is an exchange of ions between both of the compounds. Let us see a few examples. This is barium chloride and this is sodium sulfate. These both are ionic compounds. So first of all, they are going to decompose in their ions. So barium forms Ba plus 2 ion and chlorine forms Cl minus ion. Okay, chloride ion. Okay. And this sodium forms Na plus ion, and SO forms SO4 forms SO4 minus 2 ion. In next step, the positive ion of one compound combines with the negative ion of second compound. So in this case, barium is going to react or combine with the sulfate ion, and this way they form barium sulfate. This is barium sulfate. And the positive ion of second compound will combine with the negative ion of first compound. So sodium is associating with chloride, so it forms sodium chloride. This is sodium chloride. The formation of ionic compound, you people have learnt in class 9th. For this, or the ions, the name of the ions or the valencies of the ion, you can go through table 3.1 of class 9 of chapter 3. One more example I have taken here, that is copper sulfate and hydrogen sulfide. They both are also ionic compounds. So what type of ion they are going to form? Copper will form Cu plus 2 ion and SO4 will form SO4 minus 2 ion. Same way, hydrogen sulfide, hydrogen is going to form plus 1 ion and sulfide is going to form minus 2 ion. As I have told you earlier, that the positive ion of first compound will combine with negative ion of second compound. So it will form CuS. Because the valencies are similar, they will strike off with each other and it will form CuS, that is copper sulfide. While this hydrogen will combine with SO4 minus 2 to form H2SO4, that is sulfuric acid. So these are the two examples to show double displacement reaction. Now, the next type of chemical reactions are precipitation reaction. What is precipitate? So, a solid insoluble product is called precipitate, which settle down at the bottom of container in which reaction occurs. And the chemical reactions in which precipitate is formed are called precipitation reaction. Some examples of precipitation reactions are BaCl2 plus Na2SO4, this is barium chloride reacting with sodium sulfate. Barium chloride reacting with sodium sulfate to form barium sulfate and sodium chloride. This sodium chloride is formed in form of aqueous solution as it can dissolve in water, while the barium sulfate is a precipitate and it will settle down at the bottom. Next is silver nitrate reacting with potassium chloride and they are forming silver chloride, which is a precipitate, and the second product is potassium nitrate, which is soluble in water. In third example, magnesium hydroxide is reacting with hydrochloric acid to form magnesium chloride as a precipitate and water is formed. See here students, all these reactions which are example of precipitation reaction are also the example of double displacement reactions, which because all these compounds are ionic compounds, so you can explain them in double displacement reaction also. Now, neutralization reactions. Neutralization reaction are when an acid react with a base to neutralize to form salt and water. Such reactions are called neutralization reaction. Here I have taken the example of, this is hydrochloric acid and this is sodium hydroxide. Students, acids are characterized by presence of hydrogen ion and bases are characterized by presence of OH negative ions. See here, acid has H plus ion and bases have OH ions. So here what is formed? Sodium chloride, which is a salt, and water is formed. In the second example, this is sulfuric acid reacting with potassium hydroxide. In this case, this is acid and this is base. So when they react together, they will form K2SO4, that is potassium sulfate, and water is released. Again, you can see that both of these examples can be the example of double displacement reaction also, because they both are ionic compounds. Now, the last type of chemical reaction are oxidation and reduction reactions, which are together known as redox reaction. What is oxidation? Basically, oxidation means addition of oxygen or removal of hydrogen from any compound. For example, if we take an example to show addition of oxygen, here we can see that carbon is reacting with oxygen. to form carbon dioxide. In this case, carbon is adding in carbon. So we can say that carbon is oxidized. Oxygen is added to carbon. Carbon is oxidized to form carbon dioxide. So this is a kind of oxidation reaction because oxygen is added. Or we can say removal of hydrogen. So I have taken this example. This is glucose. It is burning in presence of oxygen. This is respiration reaction, remember? So glucose is burning in presence of oxygen to form carbon dioxide, water and energy. See here, in glucose hydrogen was there, but when the products are formed, carbon and the oxygen are there but hydrogen is removed, and removal of hydrogen from any compound is called oxidation. So we can say that during respiration this glucose is oxidized to form carbon dioxide. So these are oxidation reaction. Let us see reduction reaction. Reductions are characterized by either adding of hydrogen or removal of oxygen. So let us see them with the help of examples also. So I have taken carbon dioxide reacting with water in presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. If you remember, this is a photosynthesis reaction where C6H12O6, glucose is formed and oxygen is released. See here, in the reactant, carbon and oxygen is there but no hydrogen is there. But when we see the product, along with carbon and oxygen, hydrogen is also added, and adding of hydrogen is called reduction. So we say that during photosynthesis, carbon dioxide is reduced into glucose. So I have written this thing, hydrogen is added to carbon dioxide, so carbon dioxide is reduced into glucose. Now the next example is to see removal of oxygen, because it is also a kind of reduction reaction. Here lead oxide is reacting with carbon. When this reaction takes place, oxygen is removed from the lead and is getting added to carbon. But if we consider only this thing, that oxygen is removed from lead, and the removal of oxygen is also called reduction. So we will see, or we can say that lead oxide is reduced into lead. Okay. Now, the main thing is that oxidation and reduction reactions always take place together, means simultaneously they occur. If one compound is oxidized, then other will be reduced. So they are collectively known as redox reactions. There are a few important things. Let us see. Substance that provide oxygen or remove hydrogen is called oxidizing agent. In a chemical reaction, if one compound is like that, which is going to provide oxygen or which is going to remove hydrogen from any compound, that substance will be called oxidizing agent. And these agent itself, they get reduced. They oxidize other compounds, but they themselves get reduced. Same way, the substance that remove oxygen or provide hydrogen are called reducing agent. If there are certain compounds which are going to remove the oxygen or they are going to provide hydrogen to any compound, they will be considered as reducing agent, and they themselves get oxidized. To explain this entire thing, I have taken one example, that carbon dioxide is reacting with hydrogen to produce carbon monoxide and water. See, in this case, CO2. Two oxygens are there, but when product is formed, carbon monoxide, only one oxygen is there, means there is a loss of oxygen or removal of oxygen, and removal of oxygen is called reduction reaction. So this part shows the reduction. What about this? Hydrogen was alone at the reactant site, but when product is formed, oxygen gets added to it, and when oxygen is getting added to it, this reaction is called oxidation. Means half part of the reaction is reduction and half part of the reaction is oxidation. That is why the entire reaction is considered to be a redox reaction. And here see, carbon dioxide is considered as oxidizing agent. Carbon dioxide, which itself get reduced, but it is behaving like an oxidizing agent because it is providing oxygen to hydrogen. It has provided oxygen to hydrogen. Okay, that is why because it is providing oxygen, that is why it is considered as oxidizing agent. While hydrogen, it is removing oxygen. It is removing oxygen, and removal of oxygen shows that it is reducing something. So hydrogen is a reducing agent because it removes oxygen from the carbon dioxide. It has taken one oxygen along with it, so it has removed oxygen from carbon dioxide, so it is a reducing agent. Now the next part of the chapter, it is called corrosion. Corrosion is basically the loss of metallic properties of any metal by the action of air, moisture and chemicals. For an example, rusting of iron is the most common example of corrosion, where iron is reacting with moist air. Moist air means the air in which water vapor is also present. So when these conditions are there, iron react with oxygen present in air and moisture, and Fe2O3.H2O is formed, which is hydrated iron third oxide, which is also known as rust, or we can say this is the formula of rust. So this is an example of corrosion. We know that when the iron got rusted, its chemical properties changes. There is a loss in its chemical and physical properties. It turns into brittle brown color powdery substance, which is not strong enough. Same way, copper surface, it acquires green coating of copper carbonate if kept in open for a while. Same way, silver articles also turns back on reacting with hydrogen sulfide. They all are the examples of corrosion. Next topic is rancidity. What is rancidity? It is the change in a smell or taste of oily and fatty food due to oxidation. Whatever the food we intake, they contain some or the other amount of oil and fat in it. If they are kept in open, or if they are kept in such a condition that they oxidize, their smell and taste changes. How can we prevent corrosion and rancidity? To prevent corrosion, a metal surface can be oil painted or galvanized to protect them from getting come in contact with moist air. Rancidity can be prevented by adding antioxidants, or we can use inert gases like less reactive nitrogen, or by storing the food in airtight container, or by vacuum packing the articles like the chips packs or certain food items which are Ziploc packed, they are also packed in vacuum, or by refrigeration of the food articles, we can protect them from getting rancid. So in this way, the entire chapter is explained to you. I hope this is helpful. Thank you. Have a great day.